We'll do that in front of the jury.
Do not stand for the premise of a malpractice, of the deviation by an attorney of what the standard of care is. So that would not be an evidence one way or the other whether there is or there isn't a retainer agreement of whether or not the attorney did his job properly. So so to answer your question, the retainer agreements, the non-existence of a retainer agreement is the problem is that the Well, you're asking me to assume there is a retainer agreement. So I'm going to just answer the question. If there isn't a retainer agreement, then they have done their job. They did what they were supposed to do.
Okay. So now let's just remove the retainer agreement. And we know how the transaction went down. How does that affect the transaction?
Well, the purpose of the retainer agreement is to put both parties on notice of what the job the attorney was going to do for them and how he or she was going to represent their interests. Make sure their interests were protected. That's what the attorney's job is. And if their interests collide, then the attorney has to make a determination whether or not he can continue to represent both parties when their interests are colliding.
The retainer agreement sets out certain services that the attorney is going to perform and what the fees are that the attorney is going to charge. And in most cases,
that's correct. It's usually billed at the time of closing.
Right. I mean, if you have a big institutional client, like a bank or a development, they may have a law firm on retainer to help them in a series of transactions. But typically, if you're dealing person to person in a real estate transaction, the fees are paid at the end, usually out of the proceeds of one party.
That is correct.
There's no statements sent on a monthly basis by the attorney to the client advising them what they've done. The attorney doesn't produce a statement saying, I called the title company today and I ordered the title, therefore I'm going to charge you 0.5
agreements that I've prepared and the retainer agreements that I've seen, the attorneys generally indicate to the client that they will keep records of the time that they spend. That in my retainer agreements, I advise the client that I will send them a bill on a monthly basis showing what I did for the services during that month. I may not get paid until the time of closing, but they will certainly know what I did during the course of the transaction.
So, well, let's say that. I mean, are you saying that if an attorney tells a client gets referred, say, by a realtor or something, you want to buy a house, okay, they come to you, meet them, all right, my closing fee is $1,100 if I'm representing the seller and the kind of conditions. I'm not saying that that's what it is, but whatever. And the client says, okay, fine, thank you very much, that'll come out of the, our cost of one buyer open out of our settlement do you, because you have a retainer agreement and you're keeping track of what you're doing, are you saying that that amount will change? And you'll charge a different fee than was originally communicated to the client?
We're getting very far afield. I thought the question was, does dual representation generally affect the transaction? I thought where you were going with this was it doesn't render the transaction nugatory, right? Isn't that the point? So why are we getting into ones?
Well,
if you want to have an RPC hearing, we can do that, but I thought that's not...
I absolutely don't. I was just trying to get to that essential fact.
I think we just did.
So it's my understanding that personal property can be abandoned, correct?
Correct.
And you're looking at chapter 46 dash 30C, which of course is in the title property.
Correct.
When personal property is abandoned, and there's a legal definition in subsection A of that statute, correct?
Correct.
So what you're saying is if it is abandoned under that legal definition, the finder of that property makes an ownership.
That's what the statute says.
Okay. But that's not all it says. I mean, that may be all it says with regard to abandoned property.
I don't understand that question.
If that's what it says with regard to standing.
Yes.
And then I believe the question about an attorney representing both parties in the real estate transaction later represent one party in negotiating a financial agreement with the other party. I believe Mr. Benedict had asked about that.
Yeah.
If the real estate transaction is included at that point, is it fair to say that neither party is being represented at that moment in time once the real estate transaction is included?
I'm not sure I can say that. I mean, they may have a continuing relationships of whatever nature in my face, so there's not necessarily a finite ending to the relationship when the real estate transaction concludes.
Okay, so assume that at least as to one party, that relationship may continue with the attorney.
I think it could continue for both parties.
Well, I'm going to ask you for is there any evidence in this case that
Lee Levitt continued a legal
relationship with the cylinder after the close of the time?
I don't recall.
Okay.
I guess my question is, what is the import of all this? As pertains to this witness's expert opinion.
Is that?
Yes.
I'm trying to get my
why are we going with this?
Well, because the defense is positing that because there appear to have been some discussions after closing, not fixed at a point in time, between Isolin, that may have been, well, we don't know, between both parties to this transaction regarding some future action with regard to some civil litigation, that this somehow renders the transaction and the conduct of Mr. Levitt unethical. Or, I think that's what's being suggested here. Based on the question, and I'm trying to get to the point where I don't think that under these circumstances that opinion is helpful to the jury.
Yeah. We are not conducting hearing to determine the ethical propriety of Mr. Levitt's involvement in the real estate transaction in question. This is not the disciplinary review board, and I've already previously ruled that this is a collateral matter that is going to. I know it's going to confuse the jury because it's confusing me. That's what this is all about. I indicated that I would allow some limited questioning solely for purposes of impeaching Mr. Levitt's credibility. But all these questions, it appears to me, is designed to focus Mr. Levitt's alleged violations of certain RPCs. And while I'm always concerned as a court of ethical propriety by lawyers that appear before it, that is not my charge in this criminal case. So on one very basic level, I don't care. Okay? Let's move on. Forgive me, Mr. Wacks, I didn't mean to interrupt you.
No, I appreciate that comment. That's helpful. That's all I have.
Okay, redirect. Or Mr. Fagen, any questions?
Aside from looking at the contract and the deed, you looked at depositions, correct?
I did.
And is there anything in what you looked at that indicated that anyone knew that there was a safe in the basement of this house prior to Mr. Schaefer finding it?
No.
Well, can I finish? I'm sorry. And then, I mean, you want to object? Object. If you don't have knowledge of something, anything, can you possess it?
No.
I don't have any further questions.
This
I.
What
do you mean? Oh, I'm sure this is better.
Just one question. If there were a agreement between Abrams and the Palmers about transferring the safe, assume that they would double the combination of the safe?
The question's withdrawn.
That's all I have.
All right. Anyone?
the, again, the reference that I made to the statute that says mislaid, forgotten, those kinds of things. If you've mislaid something and you don't have any clue where it is, you don't have knowledge of it. There's no knowledge of that, of where it is. You have no knowledge of it. If you've mislaid it, you have no knowledge. If you've forgotten it, if you never knew about it in the first place, you didn't have possession of it. So, and that's what I think is the key in this case. I mean, it's who had knowledge of the asset, of the specific asset, to know that that it was his, hers, or its.
So that's what you based on.
I am.
Judge, can I ask you? Sure. I'd like to excuse you, Judge.
Sure.
Thanks.
Kelly, my stuff.